ॐ असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतंगमय ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ ॐ प्रपन्न पारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दोग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्सः सुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत् वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवम् इन् अवर् लास्ट् क्लास् वी हेव् बीन् डिस्कसिङ्ग् त्री questions. The Lord said only fortunate Kshatriyas would get a righteous war. Only fortunate also get. In that context, I raised three questions. What is the first question? Will an adharmic person, an unrighteous person, even if he participates in a war and dies while fighting, will he go to heaven? The second, a soldier, if he dies in a war, righteous or unrighteous, will he go to heaven or not? First question, will an unrighteous person fights valiantly, will he go to heaven or not? Second, an ordinary soldier, war is a war. Righteous and unrighteousness doesn't depend upon a soldier. It depends upon who decides, will he go to heaven? The third question, will a dharmika person take part in a war? Three questions. We have to be very clear. We were also talking about the law of karma in our last class. I hope those who attended, they remember it. I am not going back to that. The thing is, whatever happens in this world, war or no war, peace or no peace, is it a result of karma or not? Do you believe it as a result of karma or not? Where is justice? Where is dharma here? Whatever happens, that is the result of karma. And karma is on two levels. That is why we get confused. Individual level and cosmic level, collective level. Any event that happens in any country, in any nation, in any individual, is the result of pure karma. This is one of the greatest contributions of Hindu philosophy to the world philosophy. Why? The Western philosophies notoriously, their concept of God is very peculiar. He is the creator, he is the sustainer. He only two aspects they emphasize. The creator aspect and then the sustainer aspect. Then who is doing the destruction? Hindu philosophy comes here and says, whatever is born comes into being, has to die after some time. Srishti sthiti vinashana. You see, every day we are singing the second verse of Sarvamangala. Srishti sthiti vinashanam shakti bhute sanatani gunashraye gunamai narayani namostuti. For Hindus, God embodies all the three aspects. And therefore, you cannot say that he only gives birth, he only protects, but he doesn't kill. This is a natural, this is also law of karma. Nothing to do with God. What is the law of karma? Anything that comes into a being, it's sustained for some time. There is no exception to this, and after some time, yes. Interesting point is, Shankaracharya defines it so beautifully. We understand destruction only after some gap, expiry date. The moment you buy something, already
It has started becoming old, isn't it?
Yeah, yesterday you bought your yogurt. Is it new or old?
How many days old?
That is it. Not as, just because you bought it yesterday doesn't mean that the oldness started only yesterday. The day it was manufactured, from that day onwards, it's slowly, second by second. But we don't take into consideration. Srishti, Sthiti, Vinasha. Who created this world? According to Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity and Islam. Who created the world? God. According to Hinduism, who created the world? The world is never created. Create, the moment you say it is created, you have to assign a particular date. It is eternal. Sanatana. Sanatana means eternal. Eternal means what? It is not created. But in that sanatana, everything comes at a particular time. Srishti never started at a particular point. Therefore, if it is anadi, anadi means beginningless. By logic, whatever is anadi is also ananta. Because you know why? If you say this has come to an end, the very idea something has come to an end also means it is something else has begun. So this table, it is anadi or ananta. As a table, it has got an adi, it has got an anta. A table means what? The shape. But as wood, as an example, as wood is beginningless. And it, therefore it is also, and it's like a putty. Take the example of a putty. You make a horse. The horse has got a beginning. Yesterday, I made the horse. And today, I squashed it. And tomorrow, I make something else. As a horse, it has a beginning, it has an end. As putty, then it is beginningless, it is also endless. We have to come back to this question, three questions. First question is, will an unrighteous person go to heaven if, even if he fights valiantly, courageously and gives up his life while battling? Second, will an ordinary soldier go to heaven or not? In fact, you can't apply for an ordinary soldier, righteousness or unrighteousness, you cannot apply. Why? We will come to that. Third question, will a dharmic person ever participate in a war? These are the three questions that we have to raise and answer. Because upon this depends upon our understanding of what life is about. But the first thing, can a dharmic person, even if he fights, will he go to heaven? The answer is, no, he will not go. Because going to heaven or hell doesn't depend upon wars. It depends upon dharma, whether he is following righteous conduct or unrighteous conduct. Papa, punya. Dharma produces punya, adharma produces papa. Therefore, as a result, either they go to heaven or they go to... Example. So, when Yudhishthira went and found out that he went to heaven, whom did he find? He didn't find his brothers in heaven, but he found on the contrary, Duryodhana and others enjoying enormously. Then he questioned. Two answers were given. Two answers. Very important to understand for us. The first answer that was given was that the rules of on earth do not apply to heaven. Here we have got different rules. Forget about your earthly rules and regulations. But that is no answer because we are still earthly people. Therefore, we need an answer from the earthly point of view. That's why we get so angry. This is an answer that is given by ISIS. You are an adharmic person, you are killing so many persons, and you are dying in the process, will you go to heaven? Definitely, to paradise. That is his logic. But whether it really he goes to paradise or to the other place, that is to be seen. He will understand it. So Yudhishthira asks, why my brothers are not here, and this Duryodhana, whom we know definitely as unrighteous, they are here. The second answer, that is where it comes. In heaven, there is a second rule is there. Those who do little bit of dharma and a lot, 5% dharma, 95% adharma, first they will exhaust their 5% dharma and then go back to the
95% adharma. So they will enjoy the Swargaloka and go to Narakaloka. And those who do 95% dharma and 5% adharma, first they exhaust the smaller one. They go to hell and then come back. What is the psychology of it? Psychology is, just imagine, in Kolkata, July, very hot, and you just run into a bank, air-conditioned room. Two types of persons are there. Those who enter into the bank, two types of persons are there. You have to understand that. The customer and the person who works there. When both of them are coming from their home, the heat is same. But the thing is that both of them will enjoy. As soon as they enter, they enjoy very much, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Yes. But the worker will enjoy whole day, whereas this fellow enjoys for 5 minutes. As soon as his work is over and thrown out, now what would be his suffering? So when a person enjoys heavenly happiness and then thrown for a long time in heaven, his suffering is doubled or not? Doubled. Okay. The other side, the persons who first suffer when they enter into Swargaloka, will they enjoy more or not? Comparison. This is the comparison, you know. An adharmic person, even if he dies in his duty, so-called duty, he is not going to go to heaven. Going to heaven or going to hell depends upon what? His past karma. That is the first question answer. What is the second question? An ordinary soldier, if there is no righteous or unrighteous war. Why? Because a soldier is not his own master. It is just he has accepted as a job, whether it is righteous war, unrighteous war, whatever the commander says, he has to fulfill. But if he discharges his duty properly, then he will go to heaven. It has nothing to do with dharmika war or adharmika war. It's a very important point. No, the soldier is participating in an adharmika war, and therefore he will go to hell. No, because he has no kartritva bhava. Means what? I am the doer. That bhava, he doesn't have that freedom. He is bound by his job, whatever it is. Do you follow that idea? As a soldier, it is his duty. He cannot decide, I will participate or I will not participate. If anybody says like that, he will be court-martialed.
So the soldiers who are in the Kaurava side...
Whichever side. They are not bothered about dharmika war and andharmika war. This is our job. We are doing our job properly or not properly. That is their dharma or adharma.
War, a lot of collateral damage happens as well. People who are not ordinary people or citizens, they suffer so much and they sometimes dement as they die as well, young children and ladies. So, having caused all this, how can this be seen as a dharmic action, even if it's following the duty?
We are not talking here about, this is a specific question. The suffering or enjoyment is totally dependent upon karma, not upon war or anything. That's what you are...
Not caused by the soldiers, who, although they are the direct karta.
Don't even bring the war question of war. Is it righteous action or unrighteous action? War is only incidental. Doesn't mean that wars are only righteous or unrighteous. Whereas your duty in your office is not righteous or unrighteous. Wherever you are, whatever be the situation, whatever you are supposed to do, that is your war. That is the meaning of jihad. Jihad means the war to conquer, to have conquest of our own mind so that we can go towards God. This is the real meaning of jihad. But people have twisted that meaning and then they have narrowed it down. That is a different issue. Third question. Can a dharmika person participate in a war? Yes or no? Both yes and no. Because there are so many people, dharmika, the whole Pandava army, were they dharmika or adharmikas? War is a particular situation. It has nothing to do with dharma or adharma. That is part of their duties. They have to do it. As simple as that. Dharmika person may participate. That means when there is a war, yes, he participates it. Even if there is no war, I just now mentioned a soldier, it has nothing to do with dharma or adharma. But even if a person, a soldier is a righteous soldier, he has no right to say that I see the whole thing is adharma, I will not participate. They will be arrested, there will be a lot of what is called pacifism. There is a philosophy called pacifism. So many people refuse to take part in the Second World War. If they were caught, they will be put in jail. Because when the country is at war, nobody has any right to say, either I participate or I do not participate. Normal situation, you are given a choice. But this is not normal situation. This is an emergency situation. If it is an emergency situation, you have to follow whatever dictates come from high command. You cannot have a choice there. And war is such an emergency situation. So we have to follow it. A person is dharmika or adharmika, that doesn't make any difference. If needed, he has to participate. The whole Pandava army, did they participate in the war or not? And are they dharmikas or adharmic persons? Then where does their dharma really lies there? Once they have decided to battle, then whether they would do their best or not, that is where the results will be decided. That is what the Lord is going to tell Arjuna also very soon. Now, we are in the 33rd verse. Atha chetva mimam dharmyam sangramam na karishyasi tata swadharmam kirtincha hitva papam avapsyasi. But if you will not fight this righteous war, then having abandoned your own duty and fame, you shall incur sin. This is a very specific verse, so let us discuss it. To whom this teaching is addressed? To Arjuna. By whom? By the Lord. Now, Krishna was not addressing an ordinary soldier. He is addressing the very commander-in-chief of the entire army. Suppose there is a person and he is taken into the... He wants... They are advertising. Will you join the fight or not? He has a choice. Either to join or not to join. He has a choice. But Arjuna had no choice. Yeah. Why? Why? Because his, by very birth, his duty is to keep righteousness, to protect people from unrighteousness. Now, war is incidental. Protection from unrighteousness is the main issue there. Do you see the point? War is not the real point. That is only an incident. That's why it came only in the last moment. Until that point, they were all struggling. An ordinary person like you and me, we have a choice. Not really. We don't have a choice. A very able-bodied man, if it is needed, then he can be taken by the king or by the military commandment. Recruiting, you know, as a military soldier. You have no choice. That's why every country has a rule that if there is no war, you have a choice. You can join the military. Even if there is no war, military is necessary. Why? Because if any country doesn't have military power, it is sure to attract the invasion of other inimical countries. Therefore, even to protect yourself, you need some kind of strength. So, military is needed whether there is war or not. They have to maintain. But if there is a war, if there are sufficient number of soldiers, then there is a choice for other citizens. Either they want to join or not to join. But if there are not sufficient, then it is incumbent upon them. You have to participate. There is no exception to this. Because it is for the protection of country. Which means it includes you also. Because if that country loses war, you will be a slave to the other party. When British people have conquered India, the whole India, Indians, all of them were slaves. They have nothing to say against. They can only say one thing. They have the independence only to say one thing. We have no independence to say. That is the only thing they can say. Other things they can't say. If you will not fight this righteous war, then having abandoned your own duty and fame, you shall incur sin. Three defects are there. The Lord is pointing. What is it? The first thing is, you are incurring a sin by not doing what is your duty. Second is, if you do not do your duty, then people will notice and then dishonor will come to you. This is a fellow who did not discharge his duty properly. Just imagine, if none of us obey any discharge any of our duties, what is going to happen? chaos. Even in the smallest unit, a family is called the smallest unit, even there will be chaos. Then the, what is the third thing? By abandoning one's dharma. Abandoning means what? Not doing one's dharma properly. There are two ways of doing it. Differently and indifferently. Different means what? With all your sincerity, intelligence, hard labor, time, energy, etc. If we do, then that is called proper discharge of the duties. If not, it is called dereliction. So many people do it. That's why Swami Ranganathananji used to tell, every Indian born in India is a born karma yogi. He has absolutely no interest in doing his duties. Disinterested karma, which is another misinterpretation of karma yoga. All Indians are like that. Whereas in these countries, they are born patriot. They are very strong. If anybody says against their country, their culture or their language or anything, they take terrible offense. This is called patriotism. And Hindus lack those patriotistic things. Indians in general, that is what Swami used to lament. That this, why we were under the slavery for nearly how many since the 6th century AD until the independence. And after that, we are still worse slaves. By whom? By our own people. Previously, others used to loot. Now, who is looting? Our own people are looting. Three things he said. Negligence of duty brings general what is called unrighteousness. Then he will also get bad name, akirti. Then third, by not discharging one's duty, one incurs sin. This is a special sin called pratyavaya. I mentioned two types of sins, if you remember, omission and commission. Sins are of two types, omission and commission, vidhi and nishedha. Not to do what we are prescribed to do is called omission. And to do what we are not supposed to do is called commission. Both lead, the result will be only sin. Sin means suffering. That is the law of karma. This is what the Lord is telling. And the commentary is, why are we born? What is our dharma? Sri Ramakrishna used specific words with beautiful definitions. Who is a manush? Jar. Man, hush, he who is very conscious of his real nature. Mana means here. Normal translation of mana means is good name. But here in this special sense, I am a human being. So behave like a human being. But Hinduism doesn't even stop there. He says, you are not a human being. You are really divine. Each soul is potentially divine. And that's what unconsciously we are struggling. Not to die, not to be ignorant, and not to be unhappy. Sat, Chit, and Ananda. Unconsciously we are doing. And when we grow up, our teachers, our elders, our scriptures are again and again telling, you are divine. So God created you means what? Indirectly, the moment you say God created you, if you are created by God, then who are you? Yeah, if your parents are human being, then who are you? Human being. If your parent is God, then who are you? The divine. So what is your nature? To live worthy of being a divine being. That is the meaning of initiation, mantra diksha. So the before initiation, you are a human being. But after initiation, you are not a human being. This is what you call baptism in church, or you call it vijatva, the sacred thread ceremony. Sacred thread indicates second birth, dvija. Dvija means twice born. But we are all dvijas only. Every bird is a dvija. Yes, every bird is a dvija. It is born twice. First it is born as a egg, and afterwards it is born into a particular chicken or bird or whatever it is it not? We are also like that. First, even though we say biologically, only difference is, in birds it is an externally first egg, then the second, this chicken or bird. But in our case, the mother's egg is fertilized. But only thing is, the whole development takes place within, internally. And then we are born. Otherwise, there is no difference. We should not be dvijas in that sense. we have to be Dvijas means second birth. Second birth means spiritual birth. That is why every Dvija is given three threads. Sacred thread contains three strands. What are these three strands? What do they stand for? Control in two ways. That I will keep my gross body, subtle body and causal body pure. Or I will have control over my mind, speech and actions. It is to remind us that I have taken a vow. In fact, they have to take a vow. So it is a spiritual birth. Means you will be growing what? Spiritually. If you are born humanly, then you grow as what? Human being. If you are born spiritually, then you have to be grow up also as what? Spiritually. To remind us, every day this prayer is uttered. Morning and evening. Sandhya time. That is why it is called Sandhya Upasana. Sandhya means what? Dawn and dusk. What is the most famous mantra? Essence of the whole Sandhya Vandana? Gayatri mantra. What is the essence of Gayatri mantra? O Lord, I meditate upon you. You guide my understanding. God gives us understanding. God can give only one understanding. A wicked fellow, if he gives advice to you, then what advice he will give? Only wicked. If a saint gives you advice, what advice he will give you? What advice God can give you? That you are divine and so you came from me, you come back to me. You live in me, you come back to me. This is the only meaning. Recently, I heard a beautiful lecture by one of our Swamis. And the lecture is so astonishing. Just mention it as your appetizer. We have got five mothers. Usually if you are asked, how many mothers do you have? You will say only one mother. What are the five mothers? First of all, who is a mother? A mother is one who gives birth to the baby and who protects the baby, who nourishes the baby and who brings up the baby to become worthy of the mother. We have got five mothers. What are those five mothers? The first mother is? Or the
birth mother.
The second mother is Desha, the country in which we are born. The third mother is the language. That's why we always say mother tongue. About the Desha also, there is a wonderful sloka. Janani janma bhumischa swargadapi gariyasi. And so our mother and the country in which we are born, both are superior to even a heaven. That means it is a matter of great joy. Language. Then this is the third mother. And what is the fourth mother? It is Sanskruti. The culture, the tradition. Because it is, we are nothing but the outcome of our culture. Each one of us is the outcome of our culture. Nothing but our culture. Whatever, whether it is right or wrong is a different issue, but we are what? Our culture from the birth, how we have grown up, what ideas we have been brought up with, etc. We believe mostly. What is the last one? God as the Divine Mother. How many mothers?
Five
mothers. In that, the Swami was mentioning something very interesting. He read a book. And in that book, he remembered there was a beautiful conversation. There were twins growing in the mother's womb, twins. And they are almost grown up, you know. And then they were having a conversation. One was a believer and one was a non-believer. The believer was, I wonder what happens, whether there is any life after delivery. The other one says, you are a stupid fellow. This is all, nothing is seen. It is all on the kardechi. So there is no life at all after delivery. Means as we say, whether there is life after death or not. Then the other fellow, no, there must be there because we are being nourished here. He says, what is the guarantee that we will be nourished later on? So there is somebody who is looking after. I don't see anybody. And then the next conversation is, if at all there is a life, what type of life? Do you think that one fellow is telling? Maybe we will walk with our legs. Maybe we will see with our eyes. Maybe we will hear with our ears. Maybe we will eat with our mouth. This is a believer. The other fellow is, you stupid fellow, you don't have that much brain at all. Where is the need? Now do you think that how are we living? Everything is going inside automatically. We don't need to move anywhere. There is no need to move anywhere. Life is so comfortable here. Live happily, forget about everything. Just be happy. Do you think that there is somebody who is looking after us? This was one of the questions that was raised. Imaginary conversation between two babies, both are in the womb. One fellow says, it's all bunk. Yeah, there is nothing here. That is all here. The moment we come out, that is the end of every life. There is no more. The other fellow says, no, no, no. Sometimes, occasionally, I open my eyes, faintly I see some light. Then, whenever I am in distress, I see somebody softly calling me, my baby, don't worry. And somebody is slowly caressing me, soothing me. I feel it. I hear the voice. Therefore, these are all called delusions. Your own immature brain is manufacturing all this. Simply eat, drink and sleep, and that is the end of life. Is this not exactly the conversation we are having now about life after death? Anyway, it's a beautiful thing. Now, coming back to her, if anyone neglects his or her duties, and all of us have our duties, the war is only incidental. Every moment of life, we have a duty. What is the duty of a baby? To eat, to sleep, and to grow up healthily, beautifully. What is the duty of a student? That is what in our Vedas, Brahmachari Ashrama, Garhasthya Ashrama, Vanaprastha Ashrama, and Sannyas Ashrama. What is the duty of particular, here is a householder and here is a monk. These are all duties very elaborately, they have been outlined in Mahabharata, especially in the which parva? Shanti parva. Shanti parva. It is all coming. Even now, we have to understand, we are gathered here today. For what? To hear about Bhagavad Gita. So what is our duty? What is my duty? To understand it and to try to express it to the best of my ability is my dharma. If I don't do it, I am incurring sin. How do I incur? One of our Swamis was again making fun. You know, he was a great teacher of Advaita. Many times he says, if I speak too much of Advaita, I am going to remain Advaitin. Means what? All the students will disappear. I remain alone. That means I am Advaitin. Yeah. What is my duty? To understand the subject, because I have taken upon myself the role of explain. I have to understand. First. Secondly, I have to try to find out how best I can express my understanding, convey it to you. That is all I can do. What is your duty? To pay attention and to try to understand and then grasp it and then keep it in memory so that next class you will not look blank. Yeah, that's your duty. If you don't do it, then it is not much good. So this is your duty. So long as you are here, you forget about everything else and then pay attention. Try to understand. You have to try. How much you understand, that is different. Everybody doesn't understand equally. Everyone will understand differently. Famous example, one day Swamiji heard from Sri Ramakrishna's mouth the three tenets of Vaishnava Dharma. Name Ruchi, Jive Daya, Vaishnava Seva. And Sri Ramakrishna, he heard it. That is the essence of Vaishnavism. What is it? Delight in God's name. Jivedaya means those who are not devotees have compassion towards them. And Vaishnava Seva. That means always serve the holy people. Taking delight in God's name, service of the holy people, very clear. But the moment he came to this Jivedaya, he went into ecstatic state. He came back and said, who the hell are you in showing compassion? Because you have not created. It is someone else who created. Therefore, whose responsibility is that? The creator's responsibility to look after that person. Who are you? But what can I do for your own development, for your own spiritual progress? You will have to serve that person in the spirit of, I am not serving anybody else, I am serving only God. That's your duty. Shiva Gyane Jiva Shiva. You see, in one day, in one stroke, he has changed the whole tenets of Vaishnavism. Name Ruchi, excellent. Vaishnava Seva, excellent. But Jiva, Daya, gone completely. Many people heard. Narendra Rada also heard. Then he came out. And then he said, today I have heard something extraordinary. Everybody said, what extraordinary? He has been talking about these things so many times. We have heard it so many times. What is so extraordinary? Then Swami first made fun. So he said, your brains are made up of cow dung. What else can I expect from you? Then they explain it. How Sri Ramakrishna had brought that harmony between Bhakti Yoga and Jnana Yoga through Karma Yoga. Previously, Bhakti Yoga was separate path, Jnana Yoga was separate path, no connection with the world. But now, Sri Ramakrishna had brought a beautiful harmony between the devotional path and the path of knowledge. But what is it that unites both these and makes it harmony? It is only one. What is it? Karma Yoga. What is Karma Yoga here? What does Jnana Yoga say? Jnana Yoga says everything is God. What does Bhakti Yoga say? It says everything is divine, but God is supreme. I am low, God is high. How to bring about this reconciliation? For bhaktas, you must have the knowledge through this that whomsoever you are serving, he is God. For Jnani also, for Jnanis, they'll ignore the Ajnanis. No, you should not ignore them. Because they are also as existent as you. So you can't say they don't exist. Many stupid people in North India, it is their way of saying, Duniya Trikal mein hai nahi. I added, except breakfast time, lunch time, and dinner time. That time the Jagat exists. Once I have finished my breakfast, lunch, or dinner, you let the world go to other place. Then Swamiji, you know, he alone understood. What is my point here? Those words of Sri Ramakrishna were heard by so many people. How many people understood the significance of this? Now I will extend a little bit, but this actually belongs to Jnana Yoga lecture. Now how does it help the Western people? Because there are so many Western people, and Western people can be divided into two categories. The believers as well as the non-believers. Now the believers, they go to churches, they read Bible, etc., whatever it is. But the non-believers, there is something in them which is lacking in Hindus, Indians. What is it? Here people believe in philanthropy, in service. You know, so many, the moment somebody is suffering, immediately they will raise some funds and do so many things. But they are not doing it. In the right, they are doing the karma, but they are not doing the karma yoga. Swamiji's message will come, okay, anyway you are doing it, just add a little bit. What is that bit? Don't think you are serving a wretched human being. The same thing, the Jiva Daya, these people also, others are suffering, so it is our duty to help other people. This is very strong, and that's why they can raise millions for any type of charity. Swamiji's message is, if you don't want to believe in God, that's fine. But when you serve other person, do not degrade the other person. Rather, you serve the person as a manifestation of God, even if you do not believe in God. This is how you will also progress in spiritual life. Progress in spiritual life doesn't depend upon our belief or non-belief. It depends upon how we discharge our duties, most important. This is the meaning. What is the mission of everybody? Each soul is potentially divine. Therefore, what is the goal? To manifest this divinity. That is called dharma. To manifest our potential divinity is the dharma of everybody. This is the general dharma. What is specific dharma? If we are children, we have to manifest our divinity in one way. What way? A baby has to manifest its divinity. What is the way? It must be a healthy, happy child. How can the baby do that? By eating, by drinking, by sleeping. The same when it becomes a student, then his specific duties will change. What is it? Study properly and try to understand and be obedient to your, learn respect to your teachers, your parents, your society, etc. When the person becomes a householder, what is the duty? Then establish harmony in the family, establish harmony outside society, establish harmony within yourself. Three harmonies: individual, family, and social. Each person's natural and called general dharma is to manifest his own potentialities. You don't need even to use the word divinity. Simply say that I have some potentialities, let me develop them. In any way, if you have got potentiality to be a musician, develop it. If you have got for writing, speaking, or administration, whatever, develop those potentialities. And once we develop them, then only the attitude comes that with what attitude shall I express my potentialities? Is it as a worship or is it for selfish purposes? Whatever it is, here is something secret. Here is a person who could be a great musician. What is his dharma now? Be a good musician. Okay, once he becomes a great musician, then he can use that talent in two ways. Either he can develop it as purely as a worldly interest, name, fame, money, enjoyment, etc. But the other way, what is the other way? I sing only for God. Is there any via media? Yes, there is. You know, everybody doesn't fall either this or that. There is no such border line. What is the no man's land? Okay, oh Lord, I have some worldly desires, let me fulfill them. But I also want to devote some time for, as a devotional path, I will sing for you, I will sing for the public, and I want to have both. This represents householder's statue. What is householder's statue? He is also enjoying life in the world. At the same time, he also devotes his life for worshipping the Lord. Evolution, do you see? Brahmacharya to householdership, householdership to semi-retirement, semi-retirement to sannyasi. Always remember, what is sannyasa? Pure spiritual life, dedicated only to God. That is the peak of evolution. But a person doesn't become a monk automatically to that. He has to go through this. But all the time, there are two types of progress it is mentioned, you know. Imagine there is a hillock and it's very high. How many people can straight climb like that? Nobody can do it. Everybody has to, first of all, do some exercise, etc. Nobody can really do it. If anybody has done suddenly, that means previously he had practiced 1,000 times. Like Hitler's extempore lectures. 3 days he will be practicing his lecture in front of a mirror. And then he goes and gives extempore lecture. Is it extempore? Yeah, he was a great showman, you know. Anybody, here is an actor. Do you think that this actor, he gets up at 10 o'clock at night and then has a nice dinner, goes to the stage and then acts? Does he do like that? How many times the rehearsal has taken place? This is all rehearsal. Student life, your grihastha life, your vanaprastha is gradually ascending to that spiritual, highest spiritual value, which is called sannyasa. Even sannyasa is not the highest. Sannyasa is the one step lower to the highest. What is the highest? God realization. God realization has nothing to do with sannyasa, but normally we say that one. Okay, that is our dharma. Keep that in view and let every person do his duties. Specifically, I brought this idea in our last class. What is the duty of a devotee? Most of the devotees are householders, not sannyasins. Sannyasins are also devotees. Sannyasins also have got their duties, but most of them are householders. But as a devotee, I'm not talking about household duties. As a devotee, do we have some specific duties or not? As a devotee, there is a special duty there. What is the devotee's duty? To make all efforts to grow spiritually. every moment, wait, I am talking now. Am I talking for my glory or am I talking for my own spiritual benefit? Am I talking for your benefit or am I talking for my benefit? I am not talking for your benefit. I am only talking for my benefit. Because if I am doing, thinking that I am benefiting you, it is not karma yoga. It is pure ahankara. Because this body is given by whom? By God. This mind is given by whom? By God. And this understanding is given by whom? By God. This power of expression is given by whom? By God. What am I left with? And why did He give me all these things? To do good to you. Karma yoga means I don't do good to anybody. Only two things in karma yoga. Two points in karma yoga I mentioned many times. I am mentioning now also. One is, whatever actions we do, we have to do with one particular attitude. Ishvara, Ishvara Arpana Buddhi. I am doing it as an offering to God. Whatever we do. This is the first part of karma yoga. What is the second part? Whatever result comes, Ishvara Prasada Buddhi. Ishvara Arpana Buddhi. Ishvara Prasada Buddhi. Ishvara Arpana Buddhi, when I am discharging my duties. Ishvara Prasada Buddhi, whatever comes afterwards. I should not think, some of you supposing you are entering into samadhi. What should be my attitude? I also feel like entering into, you are inspiring me to enter into samadhi. No. If, whether you appreciate or not, whether you like it or not, that's not my problem. My problem is how I can please God. Swamiji, a beautiful story he created. A story he called that food for the brain. There are a series of stories created by Swamiji. There was a village and there was this pujari who does the puja. And yes, pujari is, you know, huge belly and all that. And rarely people visit that because if they go to the temple, they have to offer something. That's why they don't want to go. So occasionally they come on special days, etc. So one day, the Chauveji, Swamiji gave the name Chauveji for the pujari. Huge. After puja is over, nobody was there. It was hot. So he leaned against the wall and anahata dhwani was being produced. Unwanted sound was coming out. And then meanwhile, a villager took into his head that he would like to please the Lord. So he came, sat down right in front of the door and started singing. And it was so horrible. This fellow singing, he never got any training. He doesn't know what is rhythm, what is shruti, what is tala, what is laya, what is raga. Absolutely innocent fellow. So he started singing. Naturally, the Chauveji's sleep was disturbed. So he shouted at him, "Hey, you fellow, stop." That fellow, he looked at him and said, "No, I am not going to stop. I am singing for the Lord." Beautiful story. It goes on. The essence, you know, punchline. The Chauveji opened his eyes, "Look here, my friend. You say you are singing for pleasing the Lord. I am a stupid fellow. I don't know much about music. Even I am not pleased. Do you think that the good Lord is even worse than me, that you will be pleased with your singing?" Karma yoga has got only two components. That is Ishvara Arpana Buddhi and Ishvara Prasada Buddhi. What is Buddhi here? Understanding. What is the understanding? I do everything to please the Lord. This is when we are discharged. After we have finished our duties, whatever be the result, what buddhi we should have, what attitude we should have, this is the prasada of the Lord. Good, bad. And will you accept prasada with disgruntling and then unhappy? Will you do that? You may not say that, but that's what you do there. In Belur Mat it happens, you know, there is a queue for prasada. On special days, there will be some special sweets, laddu, jilebi and other things. Just imagine, you are sitting, standing in the queue, your turn has come. Ultimately, you know, you reached the place. And the fellow in front of you, he was the last fellow to receive the sweet. And when your turn came, it was Barasa. What would be your attitude towards that fellow? You know, prasada means prasada. How? Like Naga Mahashaya. Not only he would eat prasada. Very wonderful. We'll stop this talk with that. For Naga Mahashaya, Thakur's devotee, the moment anybody says this is prasada, it is heavenly food for him. Prasada, in fact, is none other than God himself. When God comes in the form of food, that is God. Annapurna we call. But when it is offered to God, then when we take it after offering, what is that food now? You don't call it food. What do you call it? Prasada. Prasada means what? God comes to us in the form of the offered food. Nagmahashaya, the moment he is given and says, this is prasada, it is so sacred, he will eat. First point. Second point is, many times if you give this prasada in a leaf, he will eat that leaf also. Because that leaf also has become now prasada. Because prasada touched, whatever touches prasada is also prasada. Once the devotees found out what he was doing, thereafter they will give only in a metal plate. Unfortunately, he can't eat metal plate. That is the only saving factor. Third, supposing the prasada is turned out to be very bitter and very untasty, how would he take it? The same attitude, because there is no discrimination. This is sweet, this is bitter. No, this is prasada, is prasada, is prasada. He will take. We have to cultivate that attitude. This is called karma yoga. Very important. What the Lord is was telling, that you have to discharge your duty. That is the first injection he was giving. Injunction, I call it injection. Because when tablet doesn't work, what is the next alternative? Only injection. What is the next point? Simply discharging the duties, it produces only one result. You know what is it? It is called punya. Simple discharge of duty produces what? Punya. But if our goal is to become spiritual, we have to add something more. That is called karma yoga. Karma, discharge of karma produces punya, proper discharge. If it is improper discharge, it will produce what? Papa. If it is proper discharge, it will produce what? Punya. But if we want to go to God, then we have to inject another idea. What is it? It is not merely karma, but it is karma yoga. Karma yoga. That is the most important point. What is the devotee's goal? We are calling ourselves not ordinary people, but we are devotees. Therefore, what is our duty? Not only we have to discharge, whatever be our duty as householders, as students, as workers, as swamis, but we also have to do karma yoga. Otherwise, we are not devotees. We are worldly people. What is the difference between worldly people and devotees? Worldly people also can be divided into two types. Worldly people who do adharmic actions and worldly people who discharge their duties in the right, proper way. But what they desire is not devotion. What they desire is swarga, punya. That means they want to enjoy this worldly life. Okay? Two categories are there. Do you want to be the second type of worldly person, or do you want to be the third type of person who is called devotee? If you want to be a devotee, then your goal is not neither papa nor punya, but bhakti, devotion. And that can be achieved only through one way. What is that way? Karma yoga. That is what he is telling in this beautiful world. Adachetvam imam dharmyam sangramam nakarishyasi tata swadharmam kirtim chahitva papam. Swadharma is gone. Kirti means good name is gone. And what is the additional benefit you get? You will become a papi. You will become a sinful person. That means you will go down. Instead of evolving, you will become degenerate. Do not do that. At least from the worldly point of view, even if you do not wish to become a devotee of God, if you do not wish to become spiritual, at least to become the second type of spiritual person. That is the essence of what he is telling. But very soon he comes now, it is not enough for you to do your normal discharge of duties properly. But you have to do karma yoga. That is, he will come there. Sukha dukke samay krutva labha labho jaya jayo tato yuddhaya yujasva na evam papam Ava Apsyasi. We will come to the next class. Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanura Mardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Guru.